Our solar system is unusual in many ways, and one of the strangest features is the asteroid belt. Mainstream science will tell you that these are just the remnants of the formation process of the solar system. Jupiter is said to have halted the formation of a body in this zone. Others have speculated that this was the remains of a destroyed planet. Velikovsky felt Venus was a newly formed body that had been ejected from Jupiter. Venus at this stage was like a comet with a large tail. When Mars clashed with Venus, asteroids, meteorites, and gases were torn from the trailing part of Venus and began a semi-independent existence, some following the orbit of Mars and some other parts. The electric universe would build on this concept, but would place the origin of Venus in Saturn, not in Jupiter. It therefore stands to reason that these asteroids hold the clues to understanding what might have happened to our solar system in the past. Vesta is one of the largest objects in the asteroid belt, second only behind Ceres. It has a diameter of 326 miles. Its mass constitutes a staggering 9% of the mass of the asteroid belt. It is also the brightest asteroid that is visible from Earth. It was first discovered back in 1802 by Heinrich Olbers. He proposed that these two objects were the remnants of a destroyed planet. Vesta's density is lower than those of the four terrestrial planets, but higher than most of the asteroids and all of the moons in the solar system, except Io. In 2011, NASA's Dawn mission arrived to study the asteroid. In 2012, an analysis of its shape and gravitational field concluded that it was not in hydrostatic equilibrium. They speculate that it has a more dense core at the center. Vesta has been identified as the source of a very common class of meteorite, which makes up about 6% of the meteorites which fall to Earth. It boasts some remarkable features across its surface. One of the largest is the Rhea Silvia Basin, which almost rivals Olympus Mons in terms of height. And this is located on the southern pole. Astronomers believe that an impact was responsible for excavating about 1% of the volume of Vesta and producing the smaller fragments that rain down on Earth. The crater itself looks like no other crater I have ever seen, but we will return to this point in a little while. All over the surface there is evidence of scarring. Many of these so-called craters have sharp edges with no spray marks and are more likely indicative of electrical etching where material is removed from the surface during repeated discharges. If you look at the entire surface, you will start to notice what looks like troughs running across the entire length of the asteroid. These have presented astronomers with quite the mystery. Some have speculated that they might be the remnants of a cataclysmic impact. When you examine the location of these troughs, they do seem to ring around two massive craters. Now, astronomers usually try and date features by a process called crater counting. Here, the assumption is that the craters will occur randomly. Older surfaces would therefore have been hit more often than younger ones, and will therefore display more scars. But when they examined the craters on Vesta, they found that there wasn't enough information to solidly determine how the basin and troughs were related to each other. This means that they cannot conclusively link the age of either crater to the age of the troughs. When we examine the images of both poles of Vesta, something rather remarkable stands out immediately. They simply do not look like craters at all. In the south pole, we see the elevated part off-center in the basin. All around the basin, the land is higher, with what appears as a much sharper ridge to the right. All along the left, and leading both the top and bottom, we see marks that, if this was a much larger body, would be interpreted as erosion due to water flow. Yet there is no flowing water on Vesta, nor has there ever been any. Further out to the upper right-hand side are the trench lines that encircle about three-quarters of the area. These features and their connection are really not as obvious when you examine individual images on the surface. Now, many of you will recognize these types of features from Mars, where electrical scarring reshaped the landscape. Here we seem to have uncovered a relic like no others. It has examples of dome craters. The southern, and to a lesser extent the northern basin, has very clear rampart edges. Slightly off-center, in the southern basin, we also find the peak, which is not visible in the northern hemisphere. More remarkable is the river-like shapes that seem to fan away and towards the central basin. They are very reminiscent of those found on Mars and also Earth, although in the latter case most now contain water in the form of rivers, hiding their origin from view. The other pole on Vesta also contains some very strange land features, none more striking than what appears as large areas which are very smooth. They are located around and inside many of the large craters. We also see examples of dome craters, which is a clear sign of electrical discharge. So how can we account for all of these phenomena at once? Electrical discharge experiments readily produce craters with central peaks, while Thornhill envisions that twin Birkeland filaments rotating around each other would create the dished peaks. The large basin also has sides that appear on three of the sides to be hexagonal, with a large distortion appearing on the left-hand side of the basin. Hexagonal edges are observed in some plasma experiments, but also in examples like the North Pole of Saturn. All the scarring we see probably stems from the event that caused its creation. If there was a large discharge between two large bodies in the solar system, this is likely to have excavated material from the surface of one of them. This is the origin of the asteroid belt. These boulders and dust would have been torn away from the parent body. In the near vacuum of space, the large discharge would have structured according to Don Scott's model with a series of concentric shells with smaller filaments within each of these, as we saw in Peratt's experiments. Now, I'll be honest, explaining all of these features at once is extremely difficult. But here are four possible ways that we could explain all of the features as we see on Vesta. The first one, a body the size of Vesta would act as a focus for a Birkeland current due to the presence of a higher density of charged particles. In this case, a discharge would tend to pinch in at Vesta. At a certain threshold, the discharge beam would start to break up into smaller vortex-like current bundles, and these will tend to pinch at the surface of the asteroid, causing the material to be etched away. The ridges along the equator might be caused by discharges that occur from the equator out to the first shell of the Birkeland current. An alternative explanation is that a discharge occurred directly onto Vesta. If we assume the asteroid had a spin before the discharge, and that the removal of material from one pole would alter the stability of the spin axis and might cause an effect similar to the tennis racket theorem, where the instability of one of the three axes of rotation can cause the object to flip over and then back in rapid succession. Could this account for both poles being etched? Examining the surface features, we see spiral marks in the northern pole region. Are these caused by etching as Vesta turned over from one side to the other? Did the filaments then break down even further, leading to much sharper and smaller etching lines on the southern hemisphere? Was enough material then etched out of the southern pole to stabilize the rotation, stopping a further flip? The third possibility is something called cathode spots. Now, an electrical comet acts as a cathode and the sun acts as an anode. And the assumption is that comets are essentially more negative in relation to the object like the sun. Could Vesta have become more negative and less positive with respect to a nearby highly charged body such as Venus? If this is true, then a discharge to the surface, similar to the first one that we discussed, and then a phenomena called cathode spots, could explain some of the etching marks that we see along the equator of Vesta. As the material was excavated during the discharge, fine dust would be ejected around Vesta, which would be partially ionized. This plasma forms a ring around the equator. This is inherently unstable and causes the formation of cathode spots, or short duration arcs to the surface. These melt the surface material. They ionize it and produce dense plasma with copious electrons, which can, in turn, enhance the cathode emissions further. These energized electrons form a highly conducting plasma channel to the first cylinder of the larger discharge channel. These arc discharges often create the form of grooves pitted out of the surface of the cathode. The last possibility is slightly more radical. Now, some of you will be familiar with a series that I created showing Anthony Peratt's concept of how galaxies form in a plasma universe. What he discovered was that plasma sheets tend to break down into filaments, which in turn tend to pair up and wrap around each other. There was a delicate balance between the repulsion of like charges at short range and the long-range attraction due to the magnetic field each filament created. This means that as the two filaments approached, an area is created between the two filaments where local material, which is not part of the filament, gets compressed. In Peratt's model, this central area would eventually form the galaxy. What if an ongoing discharge between two larger bodies was ejecting material and dust into the surrounding space? The discharge channel was becoming unstable and breaking down into smaller filaments, which in turn started to spiral around each other. Could this actually compress the material between the filaments back into a sphere? Peratt described the compression area as being similar to those conditions that Eric Lerner had tested in his laboratory using the dense plasma focus device. Could this environment lead to secondary discharges that etched out the marks that we see? Now, Peratt was very clear that he felt there were no jets that would exist from the core to the two filaments. Instead, he saw these as plasma ridges that, depending on the viewing angle, would look like jets. But he was also clear that he did not model the core in his simulations. So what we see as just large asteroids actually contain many secrets that help us to try and reconstruct the circumstances under which they formed. The more we examine these lumps of rock, the more that they reveal about the cataclysmic electrical events that have shaped our past.